put the load, put the load right on me. Got your cannonball to take me on down the line. My bag is sinking low and I do believe it's time to get back to Miss Fanny. You know she's there.
Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance and the National Anthem.
Flag, United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. I'm Colonel Retired Bob McLaughlin. I'm honored to be here as the MC today. Good morning, all, distinguished guests, veterans, military family members, college leadership, students, and friends. I'd like to start by asking those who have served, who are serving, please stand to be recognized. Thank you, veterans. On this day, 11 November, we have the honor and privilege of acknowledging those who have served our country in uniform, whether past or present. We remember the service and sacrifice of brave men and women who have served our country from the American Revolution to our current conflicts. I have some perspective as a retired soldier and the proud son of Lexington, Massachusetts, where the shot was heard around the world in 1775. Those patriots started a tradition of service and sacrifice that is very much alive today in small towns and big cities, where America's sons and daughters have proudly answered the call. The call was answered in Gettysburg, San Juan Hill, the trenches of France, the beaches of Normandy, in the deserts of Africa, the cane fields of the Philippines, Okinawa, Korea, Vietnam, in places like Somalia and Haiti, And now they continue to answer the call to fight terrorism in Iraq and Afghanistan in places we don't even know. We remember those who are not just part of history, but those who have forged history. Being a soldier has never been an easy job, not here or on the morning of April 19, 1775, or in today's all-volunteer force. But patriots like those long ago have stepped forward to choose service of a cause greater than themselves. They made this decision, perhaps the biggest decision of their lives, knowing that they would be sent into harm's way. For over 14 years now, they have endured multiple tours, separation from family, numerous hardships to protect our nation while we have the opportunity to live in security. In recent history, our military has proven itself in some of the most difficult environments this nation has ever faced. Our leaders at every level have displayed unmatched ingenuity, flexibility, and adaptability. Our troops have displayed mental and physical toughness, and most importantly, courage under fire. I've seen this firsthand in both Iraq and Afghanistan. They have transformed the military into the most versatile, agile, rapidly deployable, and sustainable strategic land, sea, and air force that the world has ever known. I am proud to have been part of the military every day, especially today, and I'm proud to have served alongside the greatest men and women of this generation in uniform. There are approximately 1 million men and women in uniform across the services today. These men and women have lived by the professional ethos that asserts we will never accept defeat. They are true heroes. Allow me to recognize another group of heroes that wear a different uniform. That is our police and our fire, our first responders, and in this community, they have been a big help to everybody. Let's give them a round of applause. Today, I'm also reminded of one of my personal heroes, and I would like to share his story. I first met him shortly after I took command of the 5th Battalion, 82nd Field Artillery Regiment at Fort Bliss in 2005 with orders to build and train an artillery battalion to participate in the surge in Iraq to fight as provisional infantry. Sergeant Eric Doc Cottrell reported for duty on the summer of 2005, an older sergeant who I knew there was much more to him than met the eye. So I inquired. And Doc told me that he was a reservist who wanted to continue to serve. Many of you veterans know somebody like Doc. We continued our mission with 1 year to train and deploy, a daunting task. We had to be proficient in our basic combat skills as artillerymen fighting as infantry. So we went about making it happen. I had several interactions with Doc along the way. He was well-liked and respected. Again, you veterans can relate to some similar sergeant. Until one morning, my sergeant major came to me with some upsetting news. One of our sergeants has had a fight with a soldier at a party, and yes, there was drinking involved. A timeless story. So, I was faced with the task of enforcing good order and discipline while ensuring readiness. Doc was nervous and he kept avoiding me. A sergeant that had a fist fight with a soldier, there was only one thing to do. At the time, I really didn't know what it was. About a month prior to our deployment, I called Sergeant Cottrell into my office and chewed him a little. Then I ripped up his reprimand and I asked him, "Doc, are you ready to save lives?" His eyes lit up and he said, "Yes, sir." Then I asked him if he won the fight and he said, "No." So I assured him of the later and focused on the task at hand. As we conducted operations in northern Iraq, Doc became an inspiration to the soldiers of A Battery, always going on the toughest missions and giving the other medics a break. He volunteered to be posted in our most dangerous combat outpost, Cop Nepsa, named in honor of Specialist Andrew Nepser, another hero who was killed in action in June 07. Again, I'm sure those of you who have served remember a guy like Doc Cottrell. Later that summer, during the height of the surge, we gained intelligence of an Al-Qaeda stronghold in the village north of Baghdad in a place called the Zab Triangle. So we organized for combat and in participation with our Iraqi sister unit and began searching the village. A warm summer night, I remember it like it was yesterday, taking reports from my commanders, taking reports focused on security and routing out the enemy. They had been ruthless to the villagers. Then shots rang out, and I went running. I got to a small cluster of buildings, and I saw the platoon sergeant. He reported one enemy killed. Then I turned quickly to hear the sounds of a child sobbing. In the moonlight, I saw the figure of an American soldier caring for mother and child. It was Doc helping the two Iraqis who had been caught in the crossfire. I walked up and I asked how they were. He looked at me and said, "These two will be fine, I guarantee it." Again, as I reflect on that night and that mission, I'm incredibly proud of the conduct of my troops, especially Doc. Then my attention was drawn to the spewing blood from his leg. Doc had sustained a gunshot wound as he was executing clearing operations with his soldiers. Once again, I had an opportunity to chew on him. "Doc, you should not be in the stack. Remember, you're to save lives." He explained that he needed to be with his brothers. I'm sure this is familiar. So after I got a chunk, I asked the first sergeant to get him back to the forward operating base as soon as possible. Doc tried to argue, but I ensured him that the two would be cared for and the boys, his boys, would get back safely. Thank God it was all true. The next morning, I checked on him, and he was good to go and ready to get back in the fight. That is exactly what he did for the rest of the summer as we continue the mission to destroy the enemy and earn the trust of the people. As usual, Doc was everywhere on the battlefield. In early August, I conducted an important operation involving a clearing of a village in the north with special operating forces. I opted to go to the north with the SF troops because I had to keep an eye on them, obviously. I went with the task force to the north and was very proud of the efforts that yielded several high-value targets as detainees. As I returned to the base early in the morning, I received a dreaded report that no commander wants to get. Doc's patrol was ambushed and he was killed in action in the same place that he helped the two Iraqis earlier that month. I often reflect back on the time during the surge and what Doc meant to so many. His willingness to volunteer and serve and help others along the way is inspirational to those troops that he served with and to me. Our republic demands of the willingness of men and women to step forward to serve and dedicate themselves to a greater cause. Interestingly enough, almost half of those serving in our military today are between 21 and 30 years old. America has the largest population of young veterans since the Vietnam War. Many of these veterans are now college students like here, and many have families, wives, husbands, children, parents, who face their own challenges. Being a military family can be difficult. With a wife and five children, I know firsthand. My wonderful wife, Cindy, has certainly helped us through five deployments. It's not easy to send a son or daughter off to basic training or to take roll call with a single parent when a wife or husband is deployed, or feel the pain when someone close to you is wounded, or hearing taps as they are put to rest. I've observed the incredibly resilient among our soldiers and families in the most trying times. So today, as we remember and recognize our veterans, we also honor their families who serve in sacrifice. When we think of how much our veterans and their families have done for our nation, it's difficult how to honor and sacrifice for their duties. We need to address these issues in a meaningful way. And I'm reminded of the maxim, deeds, not words. You may wonder how you can make a difference in the lives of men and women who have given so much. It might be easier than you think. Most veterans separate from the military and look for productive employment when they come back to the communities like this one. The leadership and technical skills developed in the military make veterans very valuable to any organization. You may be in a position to hire a veteran, help a veteran, a wounded warrior, or a family member, or you may be able to encourage them into a business. You may also be able to become involved in local organizations that make a difference in the lives of our veterans, wounded warriors, and their families. On this Veterans Day, I ask that you not only verbally express your thanks to our veterans, I would encourage that you find a way to put words into action. It is very encouraging, the ceremony that we have here today. I'm very proud to be a veteran and very proud of the veterans in the audience and their family members. It's been quite an incredible ceremony so far. God bless America. I would like to take the opportunity to introduce you to the Director of Military and Veterans Programs, Sherry Arfston. Sherry.
Hello. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Pikes Peak Community College's observance of Veterans Day. On behalf of the college community, I thank you all for joining us this morning. And today is the day to celebrate and reflect upon the contributions that our veterans have made to our country. And I appreciate you taking the time out to come and honor our veterans. I also want to welcome and acknowledge all of the veterans that we have today in the audience. Whether you served one day, 1 year, or 30 years, many of you made the conscious decision to volunteer your life and the lives of your family members to be part of the greater whole, to don the uniform of your service and serve in your nation's military. I am honored, deeply honored, to welcome you today. Veterans Day is the day set aside to thank and honor all those who served honorably in the military, in wartime, or in peacetime. In fact, Veterans Day is largely intended to thank living veterans for their service, to acknowledge that their contributions to our national security are appreciated, and to underscore the fact that all those who served, not only those who died, have sacrificed and done their duty. I hope you will find the celebration of our nation's veterans uplifting and inspiring, while never forgetting those who gave the ultimate sacrifice. I want to give a huge thanks to former garrison commander of Fort Carson, Colonel Robert McLaughlin, United States Army retired. for being our master of ceremonies on this special day. And thank you, Bob. It's really been an honor working with you. Thank you all.
Sherry, thank you. You represent what's good about veterans, helping students and bringing people together. I'm proud to be here, so let's give her another round. The Parley Student Journal asks students to answer the question, how do I serve? We will hear from two of our students reading excerpts from their winning essays. Jacob Crowder. Hi, Jacob. Welcome. Jacob was born and raised in Monticello, Indiana. He served in the United States Army Infantry for 9 years, deployed 3 times, twice to Afghanistan and once to Iraq. He enrolled this fall in Pikes Peak Community College on his first semester of college and is pursuing a bachelor's degree in engineering. Good for you. All right. He is the father of 2 children, 4-year-old Olivia and 3-year-old Jason. On active duty, he served in nearly every position the infantry branch has to offer. While in Iraq, he was a lower level grunt. I like that. Those are probably your words. I came to trust and respect a lot of lower level grunts that did a lot of dirty work. Thank you for doing that. Then while in Afghanistan, he had the honor of leading his own squad, which is probably the most toughest thing a combat leader can do, and that's squad leader, right?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. He led them through the rigors of combat, and it is here that Jacob had his life-changing opportunity to serve with Corporal Justin Klaus. So Over to you.
Thank you, Colonel, for the introduction. Thanks, everybody, for being here. I call this the proud few. Klaus, as we called him, was born and raised in Sprague, Washington. He was captain and most valuable player of the basketball team his senior year, enlisting shortly after graduation in 2010. He was the life of his platoon and challenged everyone physically and tactically despite being in the Army only a few short years. Being 6'3 and about 220 pounds, Klaus's stature alone commanded the respect of his peers. He had the ability to be outgoing and quiet all at the same time. During the 2014 deployment to Afghanistan, Corporal Klaus's squad leader was late to deploy with us. Klaus unhesitatingly stepped into his role and took over a squad of six other soldiers that most were much older and few had even been in the Army for a longer period of time. Leadership was a natural role for Klaus, and he thrived in this position. Having a larger role in the unit now, Corporal Klaus had a greater influence on the decisions that were made. Klaus was no yes man. He was quick with the tongue when needed. Klaus would do whatever it took to put the best interests of his men above even his own. Confrontation was one of his strengths. Once during a 105-degree day while on the most recent deployment, our leadership had us on a marksmanship range for several unneeded hours. Klaus's soldiers were near heat exhaustion, so he finally took a stand. After his endless reasoning to the higher went nowhere, he led his soldiers off the range. This attitude didn't fare well with his leaders, but he gained endless respect from his soldiers. This is not to say that Corporal Klaus was not mission-oriented. Whenever there was a tough mission, he was the first to volunteer a squadron himself. This did not go without notice from everyone. They would send Klaus's squad out on many of the most difficult missions, knowing that they were well-trained and that Klaus would know what to do when times got tough. Unfortunately, this would be the case on 9 June 2014. On this day, Klaus and his squad were sent out with a small unit of Special Forces soldiers to disrupt enemy movement and provide security for a voting polling station in Gaza Valley, Zabul, Afghanistan. The mission went as usual with few sporadic amounts of enemy fire. All of a sudden, all hell broke loose. The situation spiraled quickly as the troops came under insurgent gunfire while waiting for helicopters to extract them near the end of the operation. To suppress the enemy, Corporal Klaus and four other soldiers climbed up a nearby hill and started returning fire. It was an epic firefight that seemed to have no end. Air support was called to assist in suppressing the enemy in hopes to bring the soldiers back to base safely. Tragically, due to a miscommunication, the pilot mistook the muzzle blast from our own soldiers as that of the enemy's. The aircraft then dropped multiple bombs on Klaus's position, killing him and four others. It was the biggest American friendly fire incident of the Afghan war and devastating to our unit. The only comforting fact was knowing that they went out like true soldiers, fighting till their very last breath. I'm proud to say Klaus was not only a friend of mine, but a brother. He inspired me to be more ambitious with my future. When you lose such a young friend like that, it really pushes you to make the most of the short lives that we live. You never know when is your time. So when I'm asked, what will you miss most about your time in the Army? The answer is simple. It's not the gratitude you receive. It's not the sometimes amazing places you get to travel to. It isn't even the life-changing experiences that you get to put yourself through. It's without a doubt the friendships that you get to build and experience. It's getting to serve with those proud few people that I will always consider my brothers.
Jacob, I know Klaus would be very proud of you. It takes a lot of courage to do that. Thank you. Next is Joseph Tyler Dorman. Joseph, 33 years old, was born in Canyon City, Colorado, where he lived until he turned 18 and joined the Marine Corps, Semper Fidelis. Any Marines out there? All right. While serving in the Marine Corps, he became 0311 infantryman. I know what that is because I served with the Marines. He spent 7 months in the Garmsar district in the Helmand province on his first deployment. His second deployment was with the Marine Expeditionary Unit, where he sailed around the Pacific on a few Navy ships. I like the way that's very matter of fact. So life aboard ship can be difficult. He was discharged honorably as a corporal of Marines. Again, one of the toughest ranks is to be a corporal, and especially of Marines. He started attending Pikes Peak Community College in the fall of 2013. Now, that semester, he completed the EMT basic course and was nationally registered. Congratulations. Now, Joseph is pursuing a degree in teaching history at the secondary level. Over to you, Maureen.
First, I'd like to say thank you, Colonel. And a mistake on my age, I'm actually 23 years old. The topic of my essay that I wrote was called The Power of Children. And working with the 2 and 3 year old children in a daycare program at the Discovery Church of Colorado is my first real experience working with children. It was quite a different experience from ordering my junior Marines around. I had to be a lot more calm and patient with the children, and it helped me control my aggressiveness that I learned in the Marine Corps. It also reminded me why I joined the Marine Corps. That was so that our children can have the freedom to go to church and have fun and play and be silly and laugh. It reminded me that they are the reason why I volunteered to sacrifice for this country. It was also great to experience the pure joy that only a small child can truly display. There are warm presence in my life that helps keep me focused on the positive. In the past, I did not like being around children, and I actively avoided being with children. My 4 years in the Marine Corps was spent with young, hardened men who we trained and lived for war. I had to learn how to get out of a warrior mindset in order to work with the children, and the volunteer work that I have been doing has helped me transition from being an infantryman and back into the civilian world. The children have also shown me how to care for people again. I became cold and distant from others after my deployment to Afghanistan, and I was a little concerned about working in the daycare because of this, but it was a pretty smooth transition, and I'm glad I let them into my life. I learned that I had to let go of my hypervigilance at some parts of the day, especially with the 2 and 3 year olds. I had to change myself and how I perceive threats in some situations so that I was not on edge with the children. I was able to relax and have an enjoyable time that enabled me to have fun and be a supportive role model for the children. This was a positive influence for the children and their development, and for me as well. I feel as though I made a huge impact on some of the kids, and I know that they have made a huge impact on me.
Thank you, gentlemen. You're an inspiration to all veterans. We appreciate you doing this today. Good luck to both of you. Thank you very much. Next, Miss Laura Benamoots. Get that right, Laura? Excellent. Pikes Peak Community College Gallery Director, who will talk to us for a few minutes about her project, Battle Portraits, which you see some on the stage here, awarded Visual Artist of the Year in 2012 at the Pikes Peak region, New York-born painter. That's New England for painter. Laura spent her formative years in Israel and has lived throughout the U.S. since. She joined the faculty of the college in 1996, where she currently holds the position of gallery director and assistant professor of arts. In 2008, she began investigating and developing a creative project documenting giving voices to the challenges of service members returning stateside with PTSD and TBI. The project, titled Battle Portraits, Wounded Lions, Wounded Lambs, was published in book form by the Back Book Artist Publishing Project. Together, Sherry and Laura co-founded SFAC Bridges at Pikes Peak Community College, a unique faculty-driven and classroom-relevant skill-building center on the effective communication of our service members and students. Thank you for doing that. Laura, over to you.
Today we honor all who have endured, triumphed, and dedicated as members of the Armed Forces of the United States. We celebrate their lives, their stories, and their journeys. War and the service affect us all, though in the U.S., at times, there seems to be a significant rift between the military and civilian communities, a rift that many have worked to bridge. For we are, in fact, all one community, a community made up of diverse experiences and cultures, a family, the family of Pikes Peak Community College, the family of the United States, the family of humankind. As we gather today to honor our veterans, I am so pleased to honor those veterans who have struggled with post-traumatic stress and traumatic brain injury. When one member of our family suffers, we all suffer. When in 2008, reports were released of the struggles of many of our returning service members upon arrival stateside and reentry to civilian life, I, like so many, was deeply moved. With the support of an innovation grant from the Pikes Peak Community College Foundation, I embarked on what would become a five-year project, described briefly before, so please excuse any repetition in the description of the project. A project that started with small drawings inspired by vintage postcard images of Native American warriors, continued with portraits of young men and women in treatment recovering from post-traumatic stress, and developed finally into a series of canvases 6 to 10 feet large, titled Battle Portraits. Based on the stories and portraits I gathered and created while meeting with service members in hospital, the large paintings reference military tarps as they are surrounded by grommets and hang directly on the walls. The images are emotional, semi-abstract works that express some of the narratives and emotions shared with me. The project has been exhibited widely and is published in a book of the same title. I'm really very proud that the publisher donated all copies of the book to nonprofits serving the military, and all proceeds from sales go directly to programming and services and therapy for those individuals. The paintings shown here are actually perfect for Veterans Day, as they do not commemorate the lost, but rather honor the enduring spirits of those who return home and rebuild themselves. Our veterans are leaders, teachers, engineers, survivors, adventurers, poets, artists, dreamers, and searchers. The central image, Poet Warrior, was among the very first of the paintings I created in the series. It describes the importance of finding a way to express what one has seen and experienced. Inside every warrior is a poet with a story to tell. The two outer paintings are the last paintings I created in the series, titled Cliff Ghosts. They recognize that the past stays with us, but we can move forward, and as we do so, the past defines us less and less. My hope in creating battle portraits was to promote awareness and to give voice to those struggling to find their own. I am again humbled and honored to share this stage with veterans, with stories to tell, and thank you for the opportunity. I thank the organizers of the event and Pikes Peak Community College Office of Military and Veterans Services for all the work they do every day to support our service member and veteran students. And to all who have served, I say welcome home. Thank you.
Lord, thank you for that. As a veteran, seeing the difficulties that service members have when they come home and understanding the power of therapy through art, it's a beautiful thing. Thank you very much. Let's give her another round. So now, it's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Mr. Clifton Taulbert. Following high school graduation and a short banking career in St. Louis, Clifton enlisted in the United States Air Force after successfully serving in the 89th Presidential Wing of the United States Air Force in late 1960s. He was honorably discharged and continued his college education, graduating from Oral Roberts University and the Southwest Graduate School of Banking at Southern Methodist University. During these years, Mr. Taulbert was quietly writing his first book, Once Upon a Time When We Were Colored, became the national bestseller, a major motion picture, and a requested gift from Nelson Mandela upon his release from prison. 8 Habits of the Heart, one of Clifton's 13 books, garnered him an invitation by former Supreme Court Justice Sandra Day O'Connor to address members of the court and their invited guests. Clifton's literary work ignited the journey that has taken him throughout the world. As a recognized thought leader on issues of the community, he has lectured at Harvard University Principal Center and the United States Air Force Academy. Clifton also served as a knowledge source content provider to Korn Ferry International. Sir, welcome. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Oftentimes, the comfort we take for granted, we rarely stop to think about from where it comes. The mornings we wake up, we go to the cupboard, we get our cereal, we go to the refrigerator, we get our milk. This is a habit. This is what we do. We rarely think about how it comes about. We go to school. We do papers. We get a job. We have dinner. And we rarely think about the ease in which we do this. We send our children off to college, keep our fingers crossed that they will actually study. We celebrate their grades, and we bring everybody that was even remotely related to them to the graduation to say, look what we've done. But we do all of this with the backdrop of something that is bigger than all of us. We owe so much to the veterans of our country. Their lives, their families, build this invisible barrier around our nation. The barrier that allows us to get up in the morning and to have our day. They, to me, represent those who do the heavy lifting that gives us a chance to shine, that gives us a chance to do what we do on a daily basis. To recognize their service and to recognize the service of their family. I can think of nothing than what you're doing here at Pikes Peak Community College today. And as I look out at the audience and those that are listening in, I see vestiges of America. So many different people from across our great land together to celebrate something that truly matters. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for inviting Clifton, my great uncle, and the Porch people from the Mississippi Delta. These are the people that I write about. I had no idea that their lives would become so important and that their stories would resonate around the world. Glen Allen is a very small community, a community that certainly did its fair share of sending their soldiers off to war. But it was also a place where community came alive. It was a place where dreams and ambitions were sometimes bombarded by barriers and roadblocks. But the power of community is so transformative that it can change that. And it can give you reason to believe when you think there are none. So when we face life, we always have questions, we have decisions, and we can make those decisions in a very safe place for the most part. And we can make those decisions because of a country that is safe. It allows us to do that. I was brought here primarily as part of a study of entrepreneurial thinking. The ability to look deeply within yourself and make decisions about what you want to do, who you want to become, what business you want to start, how well you want to do in education, what do you want to do at the next phase of your life? But making those decisions and having the opportunity to do so and the freedom in which to do it, to look at, I'm not part of a caste system. I can actually make a decision to do something that literally changes my life. I can do this in America. And the reason we can do this is because of America and the many veterans, the many those who are currently serving today as well, that provides this atmosphere that gives us the opportunity to literally seek and search and discover our pathway. This is a great place to live and a great place to discover, to answer the questions and to make the decisions. For many of us, those decisions have us making a great leap. And we wonder if we can really make that leap. Can we really truly accomplish what we set out to accomplish? Can we really do this? You know, the question that we will ask ourselves and really form it in our mind, I'm not really sure, because for the most part, none of us have everything we need in order to make that definitive decision. And it's so easy to say, I'm not really sure about this. Don't know if this is going to work. And then we get to the point of saying, well, the chasm is just too wide. I can't do this. I can't make this jump. But in America, we can ask the question, and we can also make the decision. That's the great thing about being here, that we can ask those questions. Can I do this? Will I do this? Is it too big for me? Do I have the wherewithal to make it happen? In our country, we can answer those questions. And for many people, it's akin to entrepreneurial thinking, which simply means that I'm saying to myself, I can do this and I will do this. We have that freedom to do that, to make a difference in our lives. Facing life and winning wherever we stand. We can make that decision. Literally, I remember as a young guy when I first left Mississippi, I was working at Scruggs Vanderbilt Barney's, a big department store in St. Louis. And I was in charge of something. Colonel, I was in charge of something. The dish room. The pots and it wasn't even the dish room. It was the pots and pans room. I mean, it was so bad with such a putrid smell that nobody wanted to come in there. They would just shove the pots and say, Clifton, here's your stuff. And I don't blame them. I would have done the same thing too. But it was in that place, in that putrid smelling place, that I had my own ability to make a decision that this would not always be my place. But in order to really understand that, I had to become the best pots and pans washer in Scruggs Vanderbilt Barney. And I realized later on that making the decision to be your best, wherever you stand, that becomes the success factor that you take with you to your next place. When I was a soldier, I made the decision that I was going to be the best airman in the United States Air Force. And when I got selected to be a squadron leader, I don't know where the guys are, but I tell you, that just blew me away. You know, I couldn't lead anybody, but somebody saw something inside of me that left me with the idea that I had the capabilities of doing this. And I did it. And I surprised myself. Life is a journey of surprises all along the way. And in this country, we can still surprise ourselves. This is my world, the Mississippi Delta. This was the world where roadblocks and barriers were just there. I wasn't born white. I was born black in America. And with that came the legacy, with that came everything that was akin to slavery and legal segregation. And all of those things were around me. And yet within that environment, I had to make a decision. I had to make a decision of how I would win right where I was standing. For you see, the fields of the Delta had been my way of life, all my life. It had been my parents' way of life, my grandparents, and my great-grandparents before them. I knew what I had to do. I had to get up at 4 to be ready to kick the field truck. Night when I started and night when I came home. Not a teenager. You're 5 years old, and you're going to the fields. You have no other choice. That was the world. But it was in that world that I won. I remember the day the shift in my thinking began. I was just a young boy, now a teenager on the Mississippi Delta, picking cotton along Highway 436 in Washington County. From my vantage point, I could see all the traffic coming and going from the city of Greenville into our small Glen Allen community. However, it was the rare sight of the red top cab from Greenville that always caught my attention. They were rare sights indeed. I would stand and watch the cab until I could no longer see it, always imagining the life of those on the inside, either headed to or coming from the train station. I knew their world was different from mine. Cotton season after cotton season, I watched for the cabs. But I recall the day when something changed inside my head. I recall the day when something changed inside my head. Because that is where winning starts. We either win or lose within our heads and within our thinking. You see, watching the success of others was no longer enough for me. Those internal conversations about others, their imagined success, were no longer exciting. I was no longer satisfied with the culture of servitude brought on by legal segregation and the cotton world of the rural South. I wanted what I dreamed. We all dream. But sometimes we tell ourselves that the dream is too big for me. The dream is not on my street. The dream would not be near my house. The dream is not from my family. The dream is too big. But we all have dreams. We all dream. But how do we take those dreams and make those dreams our reality? That becomes the challenge of our thinking. That becomes what moves us to the next level. I wanted what I dreamed. I wanted a world beyond the Mississippi Delta. I wanted a world beyond the heat, the humidity, and the cotton rows that seemed to never end. That day, while standing on the cotton row that didn't belong to me, instead of imagining who was inside the cab, I pictured myself there. I realized then that I could live beyond my circumstances. I didn't have to watch others. I could be a participant. Somehow I knew that one day my circumstances would change, and I would be part of that change. It was years before anything actually did change, but that hot summer day in Glen Allen, I shifted my thinking. I saw myself in the back seat of the red top cab. I was already traveling beyond the fields of the Delta. That day, I won where I was standing. This is what we all have the opportunity to do. The opportunity to win wherever we stand, whatever the circumstances are. The opportunity to literally look inside of ourselves and discover the writer that's there. Discover the business person that's there. Discover the college professor that's there. Because none of those things I knew were there. I was a kid, but they were all there. I just dreamed of something. And when I changed my mind and shifted my thinking on that hot summer day in Glen Allen, Mississippi, the red top cab became my vehicle to get me into the rest of my life. A couple of months ago, I was in Australia. And while in Australia, working with the Aboriginal people there in a place called Dubbo, it was so exciting that I could take something from my life and share it with someone else and give them reason to believe that their life and their lives and their world could be better, that they too could win exactly where they stood, that they had the wherewithal to help make their dreams come true. The Mississippi Delta was my reality. It's the world that I knew, but I also found out in that place that I could shift my thinking and I could change my life. So facing life and looking back on my journey, I realized that none of this would have happened had I not experienced community. Community, if you will, is what this day is all about. This day is about partnerships. It's about relationships. It's about remembering that none of us have accomplished anything by ourselves. It's about remembering that all of us bring something to the table, that we all have the opportunity to pour into the life of someone else. It's the story of my great-grandfather. It's the story of my great-grandmother. It's the story of my great-aunt. These are the people that thought I mattered. As you look around you and you ask yourself, who are these people in my life? You look at your teachers. You look at your deans. You look at the men and women you serve with in the military. You look at the family you love. And you realize that when other people think you matter, it changes things. It changes your perspective of yourself. It gives you a different idea of who you can become and what you can do. It becomes the old African who lives in a shotgun house, the stutterer, who believed that even though we lived on the Mississippi Delta, we were being raised to work the fields of the Delta, not to become a writer, not to become a banker, not to lecture at Harvard or the Air Force Academy, not as on the 29th of this month, having the opportunity to speak at the United Nations in New York City. No, this was my world, the cotton fields of the Delta. But the old African came along, and his stuttering voice, he scavenged books throughout our community. And on Saturdays, he would dress up in the only suit he had and load his satchel with books and walk for 12 miles into Glen Allen because we couldn't go to the library, and he would bring books to us. And in his stuttering voice, he would read to us. And as Emily Dickinson said, and I wholeheartedly agree, there is no frigate like a book to take you to shores you have never been, to lift your sights higher than you could imagine, to see yourself somewhere else, doing something else, becoming someone else. This is the old African in his stuttering voice. And at the end of every session, he would tell my grandfather, who was sitting on the front porch with us, I tell you, every last one of these boys, they all are marked for good. To have someone to walk into your life and to tell you that you are marked for good because you matter. And then that was my Uncle Cleve, the man who taught me that I could own a business, that I did not have to always be the worker, I could be the boss. That was a hard lesson to learn in the reality of the world in which I live, but it was a lesson that I saw, that I participated in, and I've had the opportunity to share his story around the world. But Uncle Cleve was one of many of the porch people that surrounded my life. Ordinary people who left me with the incredible idea that my life mattered. But again, none of the stories that I have written, they would not have happened had it not been for a cold night in Bangor, Maine, at Dow Air Force Base in 1966. I was writing the first story of my life, scared to death because of Vietnam. My roommate, Airman Paul J. DeMunis from Portland, Oregon, found one of the copies of the stories that I had written. He said, Clifton, why don't you write a book? I never thought a writer lived inside of me. But it was in the military. It was this soldier who took my papers and read them night after night after night, introducing him to a world of the Mississippi Delta, him coming from a world entirely different than my own. I grew up in the fields of the South. He grew up skiing Mount Hood. Our worlds were as different as you could be. But there we were, friends, brought together by this incredible thing that we call service, the military of the United States of America. It was there that my writing began, that I realized that I had something to say and that it would mean something to others. It has been my pleasure being with you this morning. I can think of no better place to be than Colorado Springs, celebrating Veterans Day with all of you. Thank you.
Clifton, thank you. We do have some prepared questions prior to the start. If you would indulge us, I'll read the questions to you. How can our college community, a couple of parts here, how can our college community support our vets? What was your experience re-entering? How is this different than today's vets?
Good question. Three questions. There's something in the name of Pike Peak. It's called Pikes Peak Community College. The big word and the most important word is community. Understanding what community is, understanding that it is not a concept, but it is unselfishness in action. That's what it is. Bringing that to the table through every person, from the president to the last person hired. Understanding that community is what makes that. That's the welcoming point for the vet. To know that I am at a place where I am welcomed, I am appreciated, and things that I don't understand, someone will take the time to help me understand it. Because they were there, providing a comforting place for us when we needed them. So community exploding the word community in community college to really, truly understand what it means. That, to me, is the answer for the first part.
Great. What was your experience re-entering, and how is it different than today's vets?
It somewhat was akin to today's vets, to a great extent, because Vietnam was not World War II. There were no ticker tape parades for us. We just died. It really was a strange time. You knew you had served, you knew your friends had died, but you didn't have that freedom to wear your uniform because you'd be spit upon. So you almost had to hide that you had been a soldier. It was a different time. I think that we have matured a lot in our country, that you really don't have the divide that great today as it was then. So my thought is that for returning veterans today, that it is much better from the perspective of welcoming them and realizing the sacrifice that they themselves and their families have made. I want to believe that it is much better today. But you may be coming back with more problems today. But as the one young man said there, you have problems, and you also have good stories, because the military is life, and we have the opportunity to change that life in a positive way. That is the decision that we have to make, not just today. You know, Veterans Day is today, but treating the veteran right is 365 days.
Thank you. Two more questions, and I'll save the fun one for last. This question asks if you can comment a little more on the book that you wrote after the Vietnam War.
The book that I wrote after the Vietnam War, seeing that all of them were written after the Vietnam War. So I'm not quite sure which one they're referencing, but my very first book was Once Upon a Time When We Were Colored, which actually started in my dorm room. And it was, for all practical purposes, a pasteboard box filled with stories that I carried from military base to base, and it took me 24 years to get it published. But I was determined, because I was my friend Paul saying, publish the book, Cliff, just publish the book. Of course, he wasn't writing, so he said, publish the book. Nobody was turning him down. He said, publish the book. But today, I did that, and that book has basically changed the way people view community in many places around the world. It has amazed me that wherever I go, and I've had the pleasure of traveling around the world, but it has been because of my writings. I never would have thought that writing one book would have had that much of an impact on my life, but it has literally taken me around the world.
Here's the fun one.
Okay.
If Uncle Cleve was a college student, what would his major be, part one, and what would he be doing after college?
Okay. Knowing my uncle as I did, he was a student. I mean, he read all the time. And he listened to the news. And that always amazed me, because in a small cotton community, you really don't have the ability to impact anything. So to sit and listen to the world news on this battery radio that he had concocted with things sticking out of the window in order to catch the signals, he would try all the time just to hear what was going on in the world. Now, I would think that if he were a student, that he would probably be involved in some type of international class, because he always wanted to know what was going on around the world. His statement to me was this: Clifton, the world is bigger than Glen Allen. That meant a lot, because most of my family and friends were born and died in this very small place. But there was this one man who said, the world is bigger than Glen Allen.
Clifton, that was inspirational, and thank you for answering the questions. At the end, we are honored to have you here to speak with us. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our observance for today. I'd like to thank our special guests and to everyone in the college that made this possible. Sherry and Kevin, awesome. Thank you for what you do every day for veterans and helping make this happen with your team. It's been an honor to be part of this. We are now going to have some refreshments in the Veterans Center of Excellence, and I think we're going to enjoy some bagpipe music on the way out. Thank you for attending today.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. It was great listening.
Thank you.
You should have brought my book with me.